بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. This book that we're studying, brothers and sisters, is a very, very important, concise looking book. Even though the book is very, very small, it's not more than a page and a half when you translate it in Arabic. It's only a page and a half, even though the structure of it is very, very small, but the meaning of it is very vast and great. As you're going to come to see, inshallah ta'ala, where maybe one line, we're going to be explaining it for a whole 1.5 hour lesson. For example, now the matter pertaining to al-qadr, as you're going to come to see, inshallah ta'ala. But before that, what we need to understand and also know is who this Imam, whose book are we studying? Because like I said to you earlier, ikhwani, fitnatu shubahat, there is doubts everywhere. You go to one side of Nottingham, someone's going to say to you, what? Come to this kind of creed. You have to believe that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is alive and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is hazir, nazir. He's omnipresent, he can listen and he can hear, he's present with us when we're speaking and gathering. You go to another place, maybe in Nottingham, and people are cursing the Sahaba, they're telling you to listen to this guy because he's a true scholar. How do we know who the true scholar is? And that's why I mentioned at the beginning, what we're trying to do is connect the people to the classic scholars. People who are authentic, trustworthy, in what they have taught, in what they have given. So Imam al-Humaydi, his kunya is Abu Bakr, Abdullahi. His name is Abdullah ibn Zubayr ibn Isa al-Humaydi. Abdullah ibn Zubayr ibn Isa al-Humaydi. And his kunya was Abu Bakr. And he was from who? The teachers of Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala. As the brother mentioned in the beginning. Imam al-Bukhari, I'm sure every single one of us have heard of Imam al-Bukhari. He compiled asahhu al-kitab, ba'da kitabillah. It is the most authentic book after the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ahadith in there are all sahih. Scholars have become tired in trying to find a hadith with a defect or a weak narration. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala, as they mentioned, he used to pray istikhara for every single hadith that he put in there. And that's why it's asah al-kitab ala kitabillah. So Imam al-Bukhari is the student of this Imam. That shows you a lot. Sometimes you find the caliber and also the scholarship and the honor of an individual due to his students. One of the ways to find out if this person is high in knowledge is that which he has, his works, people that have praised him, and the third thing is what? The students that he has. The students that he has. And Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala used to take a hadith from who? Imam al-Humaydi. And also from his students of who? Abu Zur'a al-Razi and Abu Hatim al-Razi. A book that I'm going to be teaching tomorrow inshallah ta'ala in lesson is called Aqidat al-Razi. From the two Imams called Imam Abu Zur'a al-Razi and also Imam Abu Hatim al-Razi. They were imma when it came to a hadith. The praises are there. The ulama have praised them, have spoken highly regarding them. And these are only some of the students of Imam al-Humaydi, rahimahullah ta'ala. As Muzri mentioned, he had 21 students. And these are only three of the students that I mentioned. Why? Because they are very, very common amongst us and we know much about them. He was born, ولد بمكة المكرمة. He was born in Makkah al-Mukarramah. ونشأ فيها. And that's where he grew up. وتتلمذ على حافظ عصره وإمام زمانه سفيان بن عيينة. And he was a student of the Imam and the Hafiz of his time. A man, a great Imam, a scholar called Sufyan ibn Uyayna. If you go back to the first hadith in Sahih Bukhari, إنما الأعمال بالنيات. The hadith that we've heard over a million times. The first hadith that Imam al-Bukhari mentions. Why did he mention the first hadith? One of the reasons is what? So when the person is reading that book, he can rectify his intention. And also for himself, when he's authoring the book, he can what? He can do it upon the correct intention. Imagine he went through the whole book, compiling over 2,000 hadith. And he did it with the correct intention, the incorrect intention, it would all go to waste. And sometimes you find that when a book is taken, by the people with acceptance, it's because this person had the correct intention. There's sometimes books that we find in every single masjid. The Kitab Riyad al-Salihin of Imam al-Nawawi, this book Imam al-Bukhari, and perhaps the Ummah took this with acceptance because of their correct intention. So you have in this first hadith, Imam al-Bukhari, he took the hadith from whom? Abdullah ibn Zubayr al-Humaydi, Imam al-Humaydi, the author that we're studying now. Who did he take it from? Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Sufyan ibn Uyayna. And Abdullah ibn Zubayr al-Humaydi, he took from him 10,000 hadith, memorized from him 10,000 hadith. وكان أجل أصحابه حيث حفظ عنه 10,000 حديث. He was from the best students and from the greatest companions that he had. Sufyan ibn Uyayna was Abdullah ibn Zubayr al-Humaydi, and he memorized from him 10,000 حديث. ثم إنه بعد ذلك لازم الإمام الشافعي. Then after that, he stayed with Imam al-Shafi'i. Most of us, we know Imam al-Shafi'i. The faqih, the imam. Also one of the a'imma that the ummah have taken with acceptance. لازم الإمام الشافعي ملازمة الظل. He used to accompany him, just like, you know, you have how a person when he walks, he has a shadow. It's an example that is brought. He used to be very, very close to him. He used to accompany him all the time. Just like the shadow would accompany an individual when he's walking. وصحبه في حله وترحله. Whenever he stayed and resided, he would accompany him. And whenever he traveled, he would accompany him as well. فعنه روى وبه تفقه. And he used to narrate from Imam al-Shafi'i رحمه الله تعالى as well. And he also learned the fiqh and got an understanding from him. رحل مع الشافعي إلى مصر. He traveled with Imam al-Shafi'i to Egypt. وبقي له مصاحبا حتى فارق الحياة. And he stayed with Imam al-Shafi'i until he departed from this dunya. So he stayed with him for a very long time. In the year 204 after Hijrah. ثم عاد بعد موته إلى مكة حتى لقي الله عام 219 after Hijrah. So then after that, he came back to Mecca and he stayed there until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took his soul, na'am, in the year 219. So you find that his students are imma, people that we all know. The ignorant guy, the ignorant Muslim, you find that he knows Imam al-Bukhari. The ummah has taken Imam al-Bukhari with acceptance. His teacher was one called what? Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Imam al-Shafi'i, he said about Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah ta'ala, and also about Imam Malik, another imam that we all know about. لولا هما لذهب العلم عن الحجاز. Had it not been for Imam Malik ibn Anas and also Sufyan ibn Uyayna, the knowledge would have disappeared from Al-Hijaz, Saudi Arabia. Had it not been for the teacher of Imam al-Humaydi, the one that we're studying now. Na'am, had it not been for Sufyan ibn Uyayna and also Imam Malik, the knowledge would have disappeared, obviously, after the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ahmed, we all know about Imam Ahmed, and the reason why I'm bringing these a'imma that most of us are common of, and we know about, na'am, is because so you feel secure and confident about what you're studying and who you're taking your knowledge from. Ibn Sirin mentioned, إِنَّ هَذَا الْعِلْمُ دِينَ فَانْدُرُوا عَمَنْ تَأْخُذُ دِينَكُمْ. This knowledge is your religion. So be careful where you take your religion from. Imam Ahmad, he said, الْحُمَيْدِ عِنْدَنَا إِمَامٌ. Humaydi, we know him. We know him to be from to be an imam. We see him to be an imam. Imam al-Shafi'i said, ما رأيت صاحب ما رأيت صاحبا أحفظ من الحميدي كان يحفظ 10,000 من سفيان بن عيينة. I haven't seen a friend that knew that has the kind of memorization or one that had more memorization than Imam al-Humaydi. He used to memorize 10,000 hadith from Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Brothers, 10,000 hadith is not, it's not something that is light or something that is small. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with this kind of memorization. And they had this kind of ilm. Maybe if we try, even some of the scholars about today, they try all their lives, they might not be able to, you know, reach 5,000 hadith, 6,000 hadith. رحمه الله تعالى رحمة واسعة. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon all these a'imma that we just mentioned. So how is someone going to come today and tell us that the aqeedah that we have, the aqeedah of al-sunnati wal-jama'ah, is the incorrect aqeedah, or come and oppose the aqeedah and hide it from the people, when you have all these a'imma who are going in accordance to these usul that we're going to be teaching now inshaAllah ta'ala about the qadr? So it makes it clear to you that you have something that is authentic, something that is trustworthy amongst you lot. And bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, brothers, make the intention that when you study this book, you teach it to your families and you teach the people, and it carries on all the way to what? Qiyam al-sa'ah. While you're inside your grave as well. We hear a lot about what? The sadaqah al-jariyah, the continuous reward. The continuous sadaqah. There is something called the ujurun jariyah, the continuous reward. Even while you're in your qabr, every hadith that you learned and you taught, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, من دعا إلى الهدى كان له أجر مثل من تبعه لا ينقص ذلك من أجوره شيئا. Whoever calls the guidance, and for every single person that he guided and called to with guidance, and every time that person acts upon it, كَانَ لَهُ أَجْرَ مِثْلَ مَنْ تَبِعَ. Everyone that follows him upon that guidance, he gets the reward. لَا يَنْفُسُ ذَلِكَ مِنْ أُجْرِ. And he doesn't decrease anything from his reward. He doesn't decrease anything from his reward. So by us teaching this, wallah, I'm hoping that whoever learns, whoever listens to the lessons, whoever attends the lessons, teaches it, then inshallah ta'ala he goes and teaches it, and then he teaches his family, his kids, and he carries on to Qiyam al-Sa'ah. And it might be one of the only things that might benefit us due to our dhunub, our sins, and the ma'asi that we have on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Because only what? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَتْبَعُ الْمَيِّتَ ثَلَاثٌ. Three things follow a person to his grave. Two things come back, and one stays with him. Na'am? What are the two things that can come back? Na'am, Abu Musa.
The family and money.
The money, and also his family. And the thing that remains is what? Is amal. The thing that remains is actions. طيب إن شاء الله تعالى, I'm going to start the chapter of Qadr. Brothers, the issue of Al-Qadr is a very, very delicate matter. It's a touchy issue. Forget about the layman, you find that the tulab al-ilm, students of knowledge, when they're studying the chapters of Al-Aqidah, when they come to the chapter of Al-Qadr, what do? They skip it. Because why is so hard? I don't tend to tell you this to make you run away from the topic. Na'am. Rather, made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, if something he never understood, he would say, Allahumma ya mu'allim Dawood, wa ya mufahim Sulaiman. Oh Allah, the teacher of Dawood, and the one that made Sulaiman understand, teach me this matter. Out of tawadu, if Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala never understood something, he would what? He would go to the mud or the dirt on the floor, and he would start wiping himself on the dirt out of humbleness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ibn Taymiyyah was an imam. Whatever fun field that he spoke about, he was the imam in that field. Out of tawadu, oh Allah, teach me. Just like a daba, like an animal, would flip himself on the floor, he would do that. So you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach you, na'am, and inshallah ta'ala we will understand, and I'm going to try and break it down as much as possible, in sections, in points. So it is easy, I've taught it many times, the matter pertaining qadr, and hopefully inshallah ta'ala it will be in the best possible manner to actually deliver this, na'am, due to obviously having gone over it many times. And inshallah, I'll give you some glad tidings. Those before who have studied this with me, alhamdulillah, in the end, they actually understood it. Naam? So, and we just took this from our mashayikh, and hoping inshallah ta'ala it'll be made easy. طيب. So, Imam al-Humaydi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions, As-sunnatu indana, an yu'min al-rajulu بالقدر خيره وشره حلوه ومره. That the sunnah with us, those that have texts can see this, as sunnah to indana, the sunnah with us, that a man an yu'mina بالقدر خيره وشره, that he believes in what? The qadr, the preordained decree, the good of it and also the evil of it, حُلْوِهِ, the sweetness of it, and also the bitter of it. So the Imam, rahimahullah ta'ala, he started with the word as-sunnah. As-sunnah عندنا. What does the word sunnah mean? Depending on the context, when the word sunnah is used, depending on the context, and also the field, it can have a complete different meaning. Allah, when we hear the word sunnah, the first thing that pops to our mind is what? The salawat that we pray after the fariqa, the two before fajr, or the two after maghrib, or the four before dhuhr, or the two after dhuhr, na'am, and the two after isha, the sunnah. In usul al-fiqh and also in fiqh, when the word sunnah is used, the usuliyun, they say, ma yuthabu fa'iluhu imtithala. That when a person does it, when a person does a sunnah, let's just say now I prayed two raka'at when? After maghrib. It's a sunnah. I get rewarded for it. As long as I do that in imitation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. وَلَا يُعَاقَبُ تَارِكُهُ. And whoever leaves it off, he's not punished for it. وَلَا يُعَاقَبُ تَارِكُهُ. So if I do it, I get rewarded. And if I leave it off, I don't sin, and I don't get punished for it on Yawm al-Qiyamah. As for the wajib, is you get rewarded, and if you leave it off, you get punished. The sunnah, you get rewarded, and you what? You don't get punished. So like I said, depending on which field we are studying, the word sunnah differs. Let's put the water aside now. We just mentioned now the issue of al-qadr. The Imam said, as-sunnah عندنا, the sunnah with us what? Is that person believes in the qadr. Is it now a choice for us to actually believe in the qadr? If I want, I can leave it off. La. When it comes to the chapters of al-aqidah, you find that Ibn saying as-sunnah, it is an obligation upon every single Muslim to what? To believe it. I don't have the choice to either believe in the qadr or leave it off. And robber is also a mentality that we need to try and run away from as much as possible. Because it's a sunnah, I'm going to leave it off. The Sahaba, they used to do it because it was a sunnah. Today what? We leave it off because it's a sunnah. And whether we believe it or not, you find that this now tends to what? Affect our wajibat. We tend to become lazy. We're not used to actually doing it on a regular basis, so when the wajibat come, it becomes hard upon a person. Look at Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He says, إِنِّي لَسْتُ تَارِكًا شَيْئًا كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَعْمَلُهُ إِلَّا عَمِلْتُ بِهِ. I am not going to leave a matter that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to do, except what? That I'm going to do it. إِنِّي أَخْشَى إِنْ تَرَكْتُ شَيْئًا أَنَا زِيقًا. I fear. إني أخشى إن تركت شيئا من أمري أنا زيقا. I fear that if I leave of any of his commands, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deviate me, meaning away from the correct path. So the Sahaba used to do something. We leave it off today. And it affects our ibadat. Knowing something that is wrong, brothers, and opposing the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يترتب عليه أمور خطيرة جدا. You find that the consequences are severe. Allah says, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. Let those people who oppose his command, the command of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to save on fitna. That they would be afflicted with a fitna. Do you know what this fitna is? Fitna to ridda. Mujahid ibn Jabr, he mentioned, who was from the student Ibn Abbas, just when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do this. He commanded you to do something. I'm not talking about the sunnah. He commanded you to do something and you leave it off and you oppose the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there's a chance that you might be afflicted with what? Riddah. Apostating from the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a threat from Allah azza wa jal. Brothers, don't be amazed if one of us tomorrow, wallahi, including myself, apostates from the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tomorrow, see me with my own eyes. Some of our Somali brothers in Leicester, who used to pray with us inside the masajid, today are atheists. This is something unheard in the Somali culture. What is the difference between us and them? We pray in the masajid, they pray in the masajid as well. أَلْقُلُوبَ بَيْنَ أُصْبَعَيْنِ وَصَابِعَ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. The hearts are between the fingers of the fingers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنْ شَاءَ يُقِيمَهُ وَقَامُهُ وَإِنْ شَاءَ يُزِيقُهُ وَأَزَاقَهُ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes, he'll put in the straight path, otherwise he'll deviate him away from the correct path. It can happen overnight. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يصبح الإنسان مؤمنا ويمسي كافرا. A person, he will wake up in the morning while he's a Muslim, and then in the night he becomes a kafir without even knowing it. That's how quick a person can deviate. And it starts off by leaving off the sunnah. It's only a sunnah, tamam. But then it leads to what? Becoming lazy. Wajibat. You start becoming lazy in the wajibat. And then you put yourself forth to what? The fitna that is mentioned in the ayah. There's a chance of you apostating if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. So brothers, when we use the word sunnah in al-aqidah, it is mandatory. I can't choose to what? Believe in the qadr and not to believe in the qadr. And brothers, the sunnah, denying the sunnah, calling yourself, for example, now Qur'ani, meaning someone that follows the Qur'an. كَلِمَةُ الْحَقُّ أُرِيدَ بِهِ الْبَاطِلِ. Even though the apparent of it, what? Is something, mashallah, this guy follows the Qur'an. I'm ascribing myself to the Qur'an. But those people that use it, the Qur'aniyun, who are amongst us, they only believe in the Qur'an and they don't believe in the sunnah. The sunnah is denied in totality. The sunnah is denied in totality. And a person, he can't be a Muslim except by believing in the Quran and also the Sunnah. Believing in the Quran and also in the Sunnah. It's from the masadir al-talaqi, from the sources that where we take our religion from, the Quran, the Sunnah, and also the Ijma'. How can a person call himself a Qur'ani when the Quran tells you what? To follow the Sunnah. The Quran tells you, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولَ فَخُذُوهُ. What the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with, then take it. And whatever he prohibited, stay away from. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ. And whoever follows the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah azza wa jal, to the end of the ayah. And the ayah that we mentioned, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. His command, let those people fear. Be warned. The Quran is telling you to follow the Sunnah. And how can we know how to pray? Just the other day I got a phone call. A brother saying to me, some guy saying to us, we don't need the Sunnah, we don't need these ahadith, the Quran is sufficient. Huh? Everything is in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. I haven't neglected anything from the Quran. Allah says that in the Quran. So this Shi'i guy is telling one of my friends, the Quran is enough. Even Allah tells you, there's nothing that is deficient in the Quran. How do I answer this? So the Sunnah has been taken, it has been chucked in the trash. Simple answer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Establish the prayer. Pray the prayer, establish it. How does a person know how to pray? From start to finish, how many raka'at a person prays if he doesn't know the Sunnah? It comes mujmalan. It comes generally in the Quran. There's no ayah, brothers, of memorize the Quran. There is no ayah in the Quran that tells you how many raka'at that you have to pray. Does the Quran tell you how much you have to pay in sadaqah? It doesn't tell you that. How much you have to pay on Eid? Zakat al-Fitr. Does the Quran tell you that? The Quran doesn't tell you that. So the Sunnah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ. We send down the dhikr, the Quran, upon you, O Muhammad, so that you can clarify to the people. So the Sunnah, you have the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that will clarify the Quran. That's why the Shia, they don't pray the same amount that we pray. You find they'll come in the masjid, I showed them my own eyes yesterday. In the university, when I was sitting down in the masjid, just sitting there, one brother walked in, one guy walked in, and you find him, he's praying for maybe a good 10 minutes, standing up and down, going, making the sujood. They do the sujood, why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْجُدُوا وَارْكَعُوا وَافْعَلُوا الْخَيْرَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Oh, you believe? Do the raka'ah. Do the ruku' and do the sujood. So they'll do the sujood and they'll do the raka'ah. But they won't do what me and you do in a normal prayer. Up and down. We have to do itminan from the rukun, arkan. Is that person, he what? He takes his time. When he comes to the ruku', he stays there. Contention. Then he comes back up. But that one is up and down, up and down, up and down. Maybe more than Allah Azza wa Jal knows best how many raka'at they do. So the whole point is, the sunnah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to them. The whole point is that the sunnah is mandatory. A person, he can't be a Muslim except with what? Believing in the Quran. And also other matters. How does a person know about the adab al-qabr? It doesn't come clearly in the Quran. There's no ayah that mentions adab al-qabr, the punishment of the grave. Rather, it comes indirectly, or you have the sunnah explaining it. Like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَنُعَذِّبُهُمْ مَرَّتَيْنِ ثُمَّ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ عَذَابٍ عَظِيمٍ. We will punish them twice. In this dunya, then in the qabr, ثُمَّ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ عَذَابٍ عَظِيمٍ. Then after that, what? They will be taken back to the adab in that jahannam. You have a hadith that explains this further. And how can we know about Hajj? How can we know about Hajj? It doesn't say in the Quran that you have to mention, do specific the time to stay in Mina or how long you have to stay in Arafah. It doesn't mention that in the Quran. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us some of the places that we have to go, like Arafat. How long do we have? 20 minutes. Huh? 20 minutes. طيب. Nothing we can do the whole Qadar in 20 minutes.
Okay, inshallah, carry on from next week.
And carry on next week, inshallah. Yeah? But for the time being, you might want to write this down. Nah. But next week, I'm going to elaborate on it. Tamaman. I don't want to start something now. And then after the next week, you know, we cut off, even though it's a deep topic. And we're still like on the first line. Like I mentioned before, the structure of it is very small, but it's very, very deep in meaning. Nah. So, I'll give you the four maratib of al-qadr. So contemplate upon it. If any questions pop up on your mind, نعم, then inshallah ta'ala we'll try to solve it next week and elaborate on every single point. And I'll give a whole dars on al-qadr. So a person, he can't believe in the qadr until he believes in four matters. And I won't give you the proofs and evidences in the moment, because it'll take a lot of time. طيب. The first one, we have to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Sorry, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows when things are taking place. And He knew before it took place. So He knew before it took place, He knows that which is taking place now. And He knows that which is going to take place. And if something was going to take place, how this will take place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what took place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that which is taking place at the very moment. So past, present. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that which is going to take place. And if something was going to take place, how this will take place. So the first one is what knowledge? Al-ilm. And these points that I mentioned, just come under it. The second martaba. Al-kitabah. Al-kitabah bima'na, every single thing has been written down. Everything that takes place, every occurrence that takes place in this dunya has been written down. The third point, al-mashi'a, that nothing takes place in this dunya except that it is by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything, from the good and likewise the evil. So someone might say to themselves, طيب, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills that a person goes and he apostates from the religion of Islam. Or he goes and what? Commits zina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills this. And the atheists will say this to you. They'll say, if your Lord now, what's that guy's name? Jonathan Fry, I think.
Yeah.
What's his name?
Stephen Fry.
Na'am. I watched a video of his saying what? How dare you? How dare you? He's speaking to Allah. How dare you allow all this spilling of the blood, all this killing of children? So all the things that take place by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. And a lot of questions are going to pop up. So the fourth matter. Al-Khalq. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created everything. Even the actions of what? The creation.